So what doesn't kill us? A horror pup. Wait, Jesus. Welcome to What Doesn't Kill Us, a horror movie podcast that's part of the Flight or Fight Network. Find us.
I love how into our title you are.
Welcome.
No,
we're keeping that. We're just keeping it all.
It's good.
Find us, follow us on Facebook, Stitcher,
email us,
Blogger, iTunes, email us at tellusyourfears@gmail.com. If you're new to our show, we pick a movie and then we talk about it. I'm your host, Crystal, and with me this evening are
Monica, that's me.
Hi, I'm Brady.
I'm Noel. Kenda. Well, she said it, but
again,
yay!
We have the whole group.
The dream team is back.
Yes.
This week we are discussing a film that's near and dear to me called I Saw the Devil, and it's a Korean extreme film that came out in 2010. Directed by Jiwoon Kim. The shortest synopsis that I have is: a secret agent exacts revenge on a serial killer through a series of captures and releases. And that doesn't even cover half of it. So that's the very simple one sentence explanation of this film. There's a lot to get into. Let's
There's
start.
There's more fishing.
What?
So are we going to do initial reviews?
Yeah. So it's... just, you know, it's starting off, it stars Min-sik Choi, who is the lead in Old Boy, which is probably the most famous South Korean film right now. And he is fantastic, and it also stars the guy from G.I. Joe, who's great. Monica, how did you feel about this?
Oh, you're starting with me. I was really torn on this one. I feel
you
like
watched
we should...
it previously with me.
Yes, you and I saw it together, and the first time I saw it, I was in a different place mentally and absolutely adored this film. Thought it was the greatest film ever. But now I'm in a much more passive state of being, and
you're happy
I didn't really
in love.
Want to go back to it. What?
I said you're happy and in love.
Yes, I am a happy person now, and I don't want to murder everyone, so my opinions... I still feel like it's a really great movie. We talked about this before. I really enjoy... There's a certain... I don't want to say too much, but there's a certain meta-ness to it. And I also really enjoy how it took a different route to revenge films. That being said, I don't think I'm ever going to watch it again. I will definitely recommend it to people who like those type of movies. So I'm still stuck somewhere between a 6 and a 7. Like, it was really good, great film, but I don't think I ever want to watch it again.
That's great. Brady, how did you feel? Your first time watching.
Yeah, it was. I actually ended up watching it twice. I watched it the first time, and just it was phenomenal. I enjoyed every moment of it for the most part. I would say I'm leaning much more towards a 7 for it, and again, like, I would definitely recommend watching it if you're okay with certain things. Yes.
Noel?
Wow. I've been watching other Korean extreme, so they're starting to blend just a little bit, or I'm starting to get a little more numb, you know, to the violence. It doesn't seem as quite as shocking now. I still have an issue with some of the strange sentimentality and some of the overbearing score. So just on a purely aesthetic level, I guess I still have questions about the need for so many rapes or so many rape murders. Like, I'm not quite sure why there needs to be so many. And I think some of the, I wish I could walk away saying, knowing better sort of what the relentlessness of it was trying to achieve. So I guess those things together bring it to a 6 for me.
Okay.
I do have a theory about the so many rapes, but we'll talk about that later.
Well, Kenda, how did you feel?
So I'm going to stay between a 6 and a 7 as well. I felt that there was a lot of beauty to the movie, despite the the horror and the mutilation and the rape and all that wonderful stuff. I really enjoyed whenever there were silent shots happening in the movie, more than when there was a musical score.
Yeah.
And I liked the human element that was there for our killer, even as detached as he was. It wasn't like James Bond where he just kept going, 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 and you never see how he feels throughout it. Or
he's like not Jason Liam Neeson.
No, exactly. It's like, oh no, he actually like has little mental cracks starting to form, and I found that a lot more interesting. I could see where you're saying that it's meta, Monica. So I enjoyed that about it, but this is not my cup of tea. So that's why it's staying between a 6 and a 7 for me personally.
Cool. For me, I guess I feel like I'm definitely more into this kind of subject matter, and I guess it's because I love a lot more overtly macabre stuff. I'm also, I think both Brady and I are more into extreme horror.
You like the viscera.
I like the viscera. I like challenging myself with this kind of material, and I don't feel like this one in particular is, you know, particularly, what am I trying to say? They do it so well that you can't just consider it an outright nihilistic film. There's really I love the Korean sensibility in terms of mood, the strange black comedy that goes on throughout the entire film. I love the kinds of, just like the smash, like fantastic performance from the villain that you're just like, who is this guy? Why is he so bigger than life, so much bigger than life? And he's just like this cool customer throughout the movie. What kind of, you never see this kind of stuff in Western cinema. There's a lot of twists that, in Korean films as well. I think they've mastered the art of the thriller. And maybe this is more towards thriller than horror at times, but I just love revenge movies too. So, and then this one kind of teaches you a more of a lesson at the end. So I'm going to have to say between a 7 and an 8
for me. Fair enough.
That makes sense.
I do agree with you on the point where this is probably the big redeeming point of the movie for me, is while it is a lot of dark material, it doesn't ever push the boundary too far. Like, it always stops right at the perfect time. Like, even in the rape scene, well, at least the one I saw, even in the rape scenes, like, it stops before it gets... It pushes the envelope enough for you to feel uncomfortable, but not enough for you to go, like, no, this is too much, you guys. You went too far.
We also have to keep in mind, though, that there's a cut that's, like, 15 to 20 minutes longer, which is what the one I saw about 3 years ago, and that I actually did have to turn it off at a certain point.
Yeah.
But the cut that I got on Amazon was absent some of that. I'm not saying you're wrong, Monica. I just want to... I don't know if anybody ended up finding this uncut version.
From what I read through, there's a Korean cut and an international cut, and the differences between them... the international cut is actually a little bit more extreme all around. However, from what I noticed on what was on Netflix and I guess on Amazon, there's actually a blend of the two where there's the stuff in the international film that wasn't shown in the Korean, but also some of it that was taken out of the international.
Mm.
But
the Netflix one that I saw had a nice harmony to it. Then it got like the perfect spot now, between the two.
Specifically, I do want to make note that after I watched it the first time, we had our little discussion that exploded. And then I watched it again with kind of the whole entire conversation in mind. And then I found an interview with the director, and I think the interview changed my opinion of the entire film more than anything else. He did
expand.
Huh?
Expand.
He did say that the international film is much more, or the international cut was much more to his original vision, and that's what he wanted to have in the film all around. So there's actually a lot going on in that, because he wanted to have that moment where people were just like, okay, this is pretty intense. But for Korean audiences, he needed to cut it so they would actually get it pushed out. One of the biggest scenes, well, not really the biggest scenes, but one of the scenes that kind of was removed that I think kind of separates the Korean version than to the international is where our hero, I guess, if that's what you know, Storm Shadow.
Storm Shadow.
He takes the scalpel and pushes it into his ankle, the other guy's ankle, and like cuts his Achilles tendon. The scene cuts after the scalpel was put in the Korean film. In the international, you actually see it slice out.
Oh. So,
But there, we know you brought up last time. There's an entire scene with the. There was question about who she was, but she's listed in the credits on IMDb as the cannibal's girlfriend. I remember we were thinking that maybe she was the sister of the girl
is the girlfriend. There was a rape, cannibal,
rape slash seduction. We're not sure.
It's an interesting scene, and it's basically it's an aggressive sex scene for the most part because old boy, I'm not even going to try to pronounce his name. aggressively goes after the cannibal's girlfriend and starts having sex with her. And at first it looks like a rape scene and then she starts enjoying it.
Yeah.
And
that's a tough
like
one.
She's like, there's noises that she makes and she's enjoying it. And she looks and sees her boyfriend and he smiles. And then she starts trying to get a little bit quieter for everything. So
he oversees. I mean, he witnesses them having sex.
Yes.
And we should just mention that the cannibal is the only friend that we meet. He's a friend of the serial killer.
Yeah. Right.
And there's a woman there, and it was a little vague who she was, but clearly, right. Yeah.
But in the full international version, it is kind of more clarified that it is his girlfriend.
Well, maybe that wouldn't be so disturbing since we know that this woman is already in a relationship with somebody who's as sick or even sicker than our serial killer, because at least our serial killer doesn't eat people, right?
Not that we see.
No, he says he's not going to eat that.
Yeah, he's like, you're disgusting.
I'm gonna be right back.
I don't know if that's better or worse.
But we assume that he's a killer too.
Serial rapist.
Yeah, but they're not feeling it while they're dead.
Well, but he keeps them locked in that room and like tortures them.
Well, that sucks.
This is the cannibal.
If I had to choose my killers, it would probably be the dude in the cab, because at least it would be over instantly.
Yes. So I wanted to discuss this with you guys. The tone of this is so like. Almost cartoonish in how extreme it gets. This, you know, it leads one scene to the next where the serial killer finally escapes our hero and he just ends up in another cab filled with serial killers.
Yeah, that was probably the best scene.
Yeah.
And the fact too, like, is because he turns around to like look at the person in the back seat of the cab and he sees the guy reaching like for his pocket or something. And a normal person wouldn't assume anything from that. Like, oh, he's getting his phone or something. But he just turns around and smiles because he already knows what's going to happen. And I don't know if he smiles or starts laughing, but it's just like,
yeah, I
of
think
course that's my day. That's laughed. My day today.
Right. Oh, do you think that's what he's smiling about? That it's
Yeah.
Oh, that's
you
funny.
Guys, it's going to happen today, of course.
Exactly. That was another part of the interview is he was talking about how there is some black humor in it. And he...
yeah.
He went in and went on to say that, you know, humor and horror are very similar. Like it's all about the delivery and the pacing and you to scare people, you have to have similar timing and a good understanding of human emotions.
Humor
and the same
and
thing with
horror
comedy.
Both generally say the things that people don't want to talk about or dislike.
Right.
They both touch on the same subjects generally.
So the two guys in the cab, it was implied that the cab driver and the guy in the back seat were working together. And was there any implication that there was foul play or they were criminals of some kind? Or were they just thrill killers?
That body in the trunk. That's what we get.
And the ID did not have his picture. It was somebody else.
Right.
So part of the black humor of that, I mean, looking at this, because it's hard, because this film is coming out of an explosion of a certain kind of cinema from a certain place, that South Korean cinema has exploded, not just the extreme horror and the extreme thriller and all the police stuff, but also, you know, romantic comedies and other kinds of film too. There's this massive explosion. But this particular strain of South Korean extremity, you know, I'm wondering, I'm trying to put pieces together as I watch all these films of like what's happening in Korea that's leading to this kind of explosion. And I wonder if that scene in particular, it almost becomes this world where Korea, South Korea is, you know, victims and perpetrators, you know what I mean? Like, if you take the wrong cab, you're going to have two serial killers, you know, if you jump into the wrong, if you walk down the wrong road. And I'm thinking about this film, but I'm also thinking about all the films together. Right. And such extremity also, of behavior.
Keep in mind that right before he meets the cab, he ends up running into a military patrol. And there's a very long, awkward scene between the two. And it's never really expanded on. They just kind of stare at each other.
It's all silent, yeah.
Yeah, whereas from an American audience, I would perceive that as he's thinking about, could I kill all these guys and take their car? No, there's too many. But from a Korean perspective, it can mean something else.
Right.
Because also, before that, I think at that point, he's just left the cannibals. Has he... Well, anyway,
I can't remember.
No, I think that one is right before the cannibals, and he just he's
on his way
house.
To the cannibals.
Well, he and the cannibal, they have a, you know, they're chatting, and they're, you know, a serial killer to cannibal killer conversation. They're old friends, and something is said about, remember when we were students and we thought we could take over the world, or remember when we were part of that student group, and
that militarist.
It seems like it's some kind of reference to the, you know, pre-democratic Korea, all the student demonstrations that were sort of rocking Korea through the 80s, that's kind of led up to the final, or were certainly part of the end of the military rule. So there's all these weird references and fleeting, they're so fleeting.
There's that old boy, the theory behind old boy is that they put him in prison for 16 years, and the day that movie came out, the 16 years earlier was when democracy was achieved in Korea.
Oh my God. So clearly something's being said, but of course we don't, what is being said? Something. Right. I mean, with Old Boy, the timing of that.
Right, and the themes of these Korean extreme films are always very similar. There's a lot of black humor. There's a lot of family issues. There's themes of second chances. There's revenge themes. There's the theme of forgetting what hurts us the most, which is a big theme in Old Boy in particular.
And then there's also, oh, sorry to interrupt. Keep going. I apologize.
Oh, I mean, there's always...
a couple of things that I've noticed is...
go ahead.
Often... I interrupted. Apologize for interrupting, and then interrupted again.
No, it's fine. I need this.
So the two things that I've noticed, in addition to everything you've said, is a lot of the films, the difference between, and of course this film is the perfect example of it, that the difference between the police or the authority figures and the criminals, totally blurred. I mean, the police are incompetent, but they're also incredibly brutal. And sometimes their incompetence leads to death and destruction. I just watched Chaser last night, and that's very much about that. I mean, that's a real satire on incompetent police, even, you know, but definitely in this film, you got one character representing the authorities and one character representing anti-authority. And of course, the whole point of the film, at least to me, is, you know, the blending of the two and that we lose track of who's who. So that comes up a lot. And then also it's a lot of these films, there's two men, and usually there's a younger man who's slim and some of the time beautiful. I mean, the guy in Old Boy, the camera lingers on his naked body. It is unbelievable. The young guy in Old Boy. But anyway, that's a different film. And this one, he's not presented as like a dish, but he's very attractive and he's very slim. And then the older character, is craggy and very worn and very clearly has lived a rough life. And in all of these films, there's some version of that duality. Sometimes the slim young guy's the killer, and sometimes he's the cop, and then the other, it seems to switch off film by film. Anyway, so that seemed to be these.
The last time we were discussing that, it led to a Rush Hour 4 Face Off 2, and
Wait, what?
Rush Hour 4 Face Off
Colon, Face
2.
Off
It's
2.
the entire title of the
I
movie.
don't.
So what does that have to do with these two male figures?
Right, because they're changing faces and whatever. I don't know.
Because Face Off.
All I
And
really
Rush Hour,
remember
Rush Hour
is.
is a, is a, isn't that, oh, go ahead, sorry.
No, I was just going to say the last time we were discussing this, I just kind of found my way into this short comedy thing, the sketch starring the Storm Shadow guy. But yes, Rush Hour is the whole Jackie Chan and what's his name?
Owen Wilson. Oh, no, sorry.
No, that's
That's Shanghai.
Shanghai Knights. Chris Tucker. Derp.
Yes.
Yes.
I'm very sorry, Chris Tucker. I love you. So I also want to talk to you guys about just other Korean cinema in general and your feelings about it. Noel, you said you just got to see Chaser, which I mean, I really like a lot. I'm always wondering how you felt about that.
I mean, I was shocked at how funny it was. It just turns into a full-on comedy. I mean, dark comedy,
Extremely dark.
but really, I mean, the key in that film, the very suddenly the killer reveals himself halfway through and to the police. And the whole second half of the film is, are the police competent enough to actually get this guy charged and in prison? And it's a real tragedy because this film, more than any of the others I've seen, is very much about their incompetence and how their incompetence can lead to, a terrible tragedy. And so it's like Police Academy meets, I it's got
This
yeah,
is
it's
how we
got like
feel.
an it's got a whole Police Academy vibe to it. But of course, because the consequences are real. And again, I think this has to have some, and in the host, there's that sense of the authorities don't know what they're going to take. They're going to make all the choices for you, but they really don't know what they're doing. And if you don't, as an individual, push your way through it, you're going to be sorry, that the monster in the host is just as dangerous as the cops and the authorities. And it just comes up in all of these films. And in Chaser, it was laugh out loud funny. I was shocked. I was not expecting that level of humor, because this one doesn't, it has, this one, the flashes of humor are very brief and very far apart. The Chaser, there's some brutality against women, but it's really more the frame
It's
and
a
not
little
so much.
pinch.
Yeah, there's just a sprinkling of it all. It's not
Little
like this where
dash.
it's like big, big chunks of it.
Right.
So yeah, Chaser's great, and Memories. Yeah, I would recommend. I watched Yellow Sea too, which was very much about the relationship between China and Korea, and how the Chinese are really looked upon as subhuman in South Korea. Chinese immigrants who are coming for work. So that's got that whole thing going on, which is more about what's going on in the present. But it's been interesting. But again, it's like, without an authority figure, without knowing more, without somebody filling in the gaps, I've got this very patchwork idea about what's going on in South Korean society. And you're getting, it's like the blind man and the elephant. Each film gives me a little bit more, but I don't feel confident to say, make big broad generalizations
Right, and I feel like
above
these
what I've
films
said.
that we're getting are more like the fringe filmmaking, such
Yeah.
as like a Tarantino film. Like somebody in another country might be analyzing Hateful Eight in a similar way. You guys, how do you guys feel about the Park Chan-wook trilogy?
Yeah, that's what I was gonna mention.
And can you just remind us what those three films are?
Sympathy for Mr. Vengeance, or no, Mr. Vengeance, Old Boy, Sympathy for Lady Vengeance.
Now, they're not connected narratively or character, in terms of characters. They're just thematically revenge.
It's a vengeance trilogy. Like they're just all about vengeance. I don't actually don't really care for Mr. Vengeance that much, But I do love Old Boy, and I adore Lady Vengeance.
I love Lady Vengeance so much.
That's my heart movie.
Yes, it's wonderful. The soundtrack is gorgeous.
Mm-hmm.
It, like, hits on...
We used to listen to that soundtrack just day in and out, constantly. Hmm. It's beautiful.
Yeah. It is an amazing, like, series of strings alone going on. I mean, it's fantastic. Monica and I are also both really big fans of this director because we love Tale of Two Sisters. Mm-hmm. And I think we also saw Good, Bad, and the Weird together, which was his big Western epic.
Wait, what?
Oh, yeah.
What's that called?
The Good, the Bad, and the Weird.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah, I didn't realize that was him.
Yeah, it's him.
I love that movie.
He also did the okay, I wanted to talk about, like, translation of these Korean directors into American cinema, and this guy did The Last Stand with Arnold Schwarzenegger and Johnny Knoxville. There was Stoker from Park Chan-wook, and Snowpiercer from the
Revenge
of the Host. Yes.
That was so good.
I really think they're fantastic. They're so interesting, these films. I don't think they're as strong as their Korean films, but it's such an interesting departure from American cinema because I never know what's going to happen at the end. I can't predict the ending of these films, and I like it.
You can't predict the ending of their Korean films, but also their American films you can't predict?
Not those three. I couldn't really predict.
And I think a lot of that has to do with they're just in a different mindset than we are because of upbringing. Like, we think one way because that's the way all of our movies go, because that's the way they've all always gone, and then their stories go a certain way. So I'm sure, like, in Korea, they're like, man, that movie was so predictable. Meanwhile, Star Wars, I had no idea that was going to happen.
We don't have enough information. I wonder that very well may be true. But boy, every single one of these Korean films I've seen, none of them I could have predicted. Yeah. They didn't follow any patterns that I knew, and I didn't learn any patterns as I watched them. Yeah, but what is the obsession with vengeance? And I have to ask Kenda, because we've talked about it outside of this podcast, of what, you know, what's the deal with why so much rape in I Saw the Devil? Why does there need to be so much rape?
Can I say my theory?
Yeah,
sure.
My rape theory, my special rape theory. I'll start it with my favorite thing about this movie is the title, I Saw the Devil. And I honestly feel like, you know, you're made to believe that when you say I Saw the Devil, it's the serial killer that he's chasing. But in reality, it's from the serial killer's point of view who is being chased by this non-relenting vengeance machine. And that is him saying, I saw the devil in this man that I wronged. That being said, because he is a non-relenting vengeance machine, I feel like the movie had to keep reminding us that the guy was a bad guy. Like, if he just killed one person and then kept being chased relentlessly and tortured, we would eventually started rooting for him to get out of this stuff.
Yeah.
But no, they had to constantly, like, throw it in our face that this guy will not repent of his ways. He will keep doing what he's doing, and he is seriously messed up in the head.
Yeah.
And then that sense, the revenge movie is basically saying you're turning yourself into a monster. You are not helping anybody by prolonging the torture of this man. You could have prevented many other crimes from happening if you would have just turned his ass in.
Yeah, instead he goes for, like, the Skinner type psychology treatment program where he's like, every time you do something bad, I'm going to ruin another one of your limbs.
Yeah, like
every time you try to rape a woman, I'm gonna stab a screwdriver in something.
Yeah, so when you think about, you
stop doing bad actions.
Yeah, as soon as you think about rape, you remember that one time that my your Achilles tendon blew out.
Yeah,
it doesn't work.
You think he has a really short memory, though, so it's not super effective. Something happened.
That learning process doesn't work. Negative reinforcement, it just doesn't.
Which is interesting. Revenge movie that doesn't reinforce your lust for revenge as a viewer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you guys.
I also think,
but it pushes all those buttons for you to. That's the meta part.
You want it, and then you're like, wait.
Sorry, Brady. Brady was going to say something, and he's going to explode if he doesn't.
Bradykins.
Hi.
Brady.
So, when it comes to the title, I Saw the Devil, to me, it's more so the cop finds himself becoming the devil. He's the one that's slipping into the darkness, and he finds all of that. And the fun part about that, you said that, or Crystal said that he could have stopped these other crimes. On the other hand, not really, because we've got our main serial killer killing the taxi cab serial killers, which that scene was amazing. We should discuss that at some point in time. And then running into the cannibal and his girlfriend. Mm-hmm. And those four people alone could have probably done three times the damage of our main serial.
Oh, and he ends up killing... Does he kill the cannibal? He doesn't kill the cannibal.
No, he's in the hospital.
No, he's still technically alive. But he's going to probably be in custody for forever at that point. So
that's true. That's interesting, but it hurts him personally more.
Oh yeah, because his should we say, or his life is destroyed by the Ender. Everyone he loves and is dear to him is gone.
All the way through. It starts off with his fiance,
right,
and then it ends up going to her dad and her sister, and that's basically all our main hero has in his life at this point. So he loses everything in this process, but does end up getting his vengeance.
Yeah, but I think the other thing I do really enjoy about this movie is it says, you know, revenge doesn't pay off. Like, it hardcore drills that in. Like, the more revenge he gets and the more fulfilled he gets for that, the more people around him get hurt and the more he has the desire to keep pushing the revenge.
Right.
Like, keep making it go farther, because it's just, he's never going to feel that closure.
It's very Count of Monte Cristo.
Yes. I was thinking Batman, but yeah, we'll go Count of Monte Cristo.
It's definitely the more revenge he gets, the less fulfilled he gets. It's like, you know, a bucket
an addiction.
Holes in the bottom and he's trying to fill it up.
Interesting. Yeah.
Much like a drug, always trying to get that first high, which I felt in the film when he first catches him.
Yeah, like, yes,
get him! And then every time after that, you're like, oh, maybe you should stop. Like,
Yeah, it takes all the pleasure out of it for the viewer. I mean,
just, if you want to leave him alive, cripple him.
Forever.
Yeah.
I'm fine with that.
Yeah, it's hard to rape a woman when you have to carry around a colostomy bag. Just saying.
Colostomy bags, castration.
No, we don't experience all of us, for sure.
Obviously. But Kenda, I know that you had talked... You have real reservations about representations of rape in general in horror films and thrillers and stuff. And I'm just wondering, I mean, I agree with Monica. I think that's the reason the filmmakers do it, is to continually remind us and to continually bait the audience into wanting the serial killer stopped and killed. But I'm wondering, do you think it's worth it, or what are your broader general feelings about it?
I'd say in this movie particularly, I don't even know if worth it is a fair phrase to use, because, I mean, even though it's just a representation of women being brutalized, it's still every single woman, you know, is fucked up for, like, the rest of her life because of this shit. And, sorry, excuse me, bad language, my bad.
Sorry, I was off really on the button. That,
sorry.
My bad.
And,
oh, we just lost the South. Oh,
yep.
Well.
Sorry. Sorry, guys.
But so keep going. I'm sorry, Kenda.
No, that's my fault. So I feel like the story, and because it had to happen for the story in this case, it was relevant and it needed to be there, as Monica said, as a tool to keep the audience engaged in his punishment. So I guess yes, but it was definitely not easy to sit there and sit through it.
Yeah. I mean, there are definitely other ways they could have done it without actually showing the woman. It's not even it's weird. The degradation of womankind doesn't really bother me in rape scenes. It's the terror behind it. Like, when you see a person scared because there's a monster, it's one thing. But when you see a person scared because they're about to get raped, that is a level I don't like experiencing in a film.
Whether it's it could be male or female.
Yeah,
it's just
the
idea of violation.
Male or female. It's a different... And I love horror films because I love terror, but not that terror. I don't like that fear.
I'm kind of looking forward to reading our comment section after this one.
I guess I feel similarly, Monica, but more to the point of someone who can't help themselves, like a child. A child is something that is way worse for me when I'm thinking about, like, well, this person can't help themselves. And when I get pretty upset in fiction when women are victimized and the women don't fight back with every tooth and nail to their, you know, I would bite their jugular out with your teeth. Just like,
stick your thumbs in their eyeballs.
Yes.
It doesn't require strength.
Yes. Just haven't watched Vikings.
It doesn't. Yeah.
Vikings? Is that the TV show?
Yeah.
Why are there...
The women are badass.
Women fight back? That's what I'm talking about.
They are like, just...
Yeah, the eyeball trick, I actually heard from the news of, like, this 75-year-old woman that almost got raped on the street. Except she stuck her fingers in his eyeballs and blinded him for life.
Wow.
She's like, next time he goes to rape someone, he's always going to think of me.
Well, he's not even... It's going
to
be hard.
Well...
Yeah, he's going to have to find him first.
Yeah. Yeah. But this was like this 75-year-old woman, and me as like a 10-year-old child is like, I am remembering that for the rest of my life, and you are my hero.
But it is a little dismaying in this film to see none of the women, I don't think a single one of them really fights back.
They don't, and that's harder for me, but I don't think that's on purpose, as far as the filmmaking.
I was going to say, I don't know much about Korean culture, but I know a lot of Asian culture is like a super macho-istic, and super when it comes to women, they're all kind of weaker. Macho, I don't know that word.
There's a machismo about it.
Machismo, yeah.
I wouldn't say it's very macho.
So the depiction of women very commonly is this weak, pretty fragile, mean. Like, ooh, girl. That will never fight back.
Well, that's what I mentioned last time. That first scene is almost laughable. It's terrifying. It's beautiful. The white, you know, the police guys, you know, the policeman's girlfriend is stuck in her car, and she calls him, and this is the incident that starts the whole thing going.
Smart.
About not talking to the guy.
She's like, nah, I got this.
I guess it's just the their conversation makes her unreal, you know, because it's her birthday and they're talking so sweetly to each other, and she says, "Will you sing to me?" And then you know, and then it turns out she was pregnant. Spoiler alert! And he didn't know.
And yeah, like on her birthday, she was visiting some children in an orphanage or something.
I just got back from the orphanage, and it's such a beautiful place that when we have a child, we're gonna bring him there because there are animals. You know, it's just like what
you
gotta be.
To remind the child how lucky he is and to rub it into all those other kids' faces. No.
That was the subject. She didn't say that. No, but it was so unreal in a way. And in a way, that whole first scene is very unreal with the white. She's in white and the car is white and the snow and everything. And it's all very beautiful. It's almost unreal. And I just wonder she's almost an impossible woman. I mean, they're as a couple, and he looks so great in the early part of the film. He looks worse and worse as he goes and as he gets more degraded, and his sideburns seem to get sharper as he, I swear to God, they got sharper as he got more deranged.
Those curly keys on your face made me so hot I can't think straight.
But I just wonder.
I still want his coat though, that jacket.
Oh yeah.
Is amazing, and I need like four of them.
Oh yeah, no, the clothes are good, although they don't compare to the J-horror clothing, particularly.
We'll talk about that in another episode.
Yeah, that's another. It's another culture, another film.
I'm ready for your like fashion and horror, Noel.
I'm still working on it. Yeah, no, there's one. What was the J-horror I watched where everybody was dressed to the nines? It was incredible. It must have been Ringu, I think. No, it was It was Cure. Watch Cure just for the clothes. Sorry.
Kenda, what were you going to say?
Sorry.
Oh, it's okay. I was going to ask if you feel that they were setting up this ideal woman almost as a satire, like this Mary Sue character that they then not like yank the rug out from under her. Do you think that was on purpose? Like to set that up? Like, this is the ideal Korean woman. Like she's interested in a family. She's She's smart and intelligent. She's sweet. She has a husband who loves her. They're in a good relationship. And watch her be beaten to death in her car. Like, that didn't save her. None of those things saved her when it came down to it.
Yes, and I feel like maybe that is somehow commenting on Korean dramas. You know, that whole sentimentality that they had with the
soap overblown
operas. Soap opera music, and like Korean soap operas are so popular right now. They're probably more popular than any of these movies that we're talking about.
Yeah,
like my stepmom watches them. Like,
I work
forever,
with a bunch of
and
that
she watches them with subtitles, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, she's Filipino, so she just watches them nonstop. And this might be some kind of comment on that fluffy part of Korean culture.
You had also talked about the K-pop culture, the sort of perfect, shiny, trendy, like plastic. Yeah.
They always get plastic surgery to look a very specific way. That's why all the K-pop stars look very similar. It's not because we're racist. It's because they're actually getting their bone structure changed to look
Even
in this ideal way.
Like dental surgeries.
Even shaving their
I saw for a while they were like, they were getting surgery to put like buck teeth in, because for a while that was considered cute, was to have like
a little space between your front two teeth. Yeah.
What?
Madonna. I wanted to mention too, as you were talking, Noel, I realized that another theme in these movies is snow, and also perverting the snow. With blood.
Like corrupting it.
Yeah, corrupting the purity of the snow. Like an old boy, that's the last scene when he chooses to forget what he's done. Mm-hmm. It's in the snow.
Right.
Lady Vengeance eats the tofu in the snow at the end.
Huh.
And I won't spoil what happens, but there's snow in this movie. There's also snow in other Asian extreme horror that I'll mention later.
Interesting.
Well,
it's a beautiful image.
Well, it could be interesting to us because with us, white generally means like purity and cleanliness, but for them, it also means death.
Death. Well, in Korea, specifically,
true.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
They wear white to funerals. You're not supposed to wear white to a wedding.
Is that true of Korea and Japan?
I don't know.
I think it's a lot of Asian culture. I know, I work with a Chinese lady that was telling me that she thinks it's ridiculous people wear white wedding dresses.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to wear one, so.
Good job, Brady. Brady, our feminist.
That's right. Stick it to him.
Well, Crystal, you wore a red one.
I wore a red one.
It's pretty
Ooh.
Sweet.
Ooh.
I wore a replica of Mulan Rouge.
She's no virgin.
Yeah.
I wasn't gonna make up any excuses. anyway, we're off topic.
Yes.
But yes, white does represent death in some Asian cultures. I was trying to look up to see if it was specifically
it
in Korean.
Or is it? Was I getting it wrong? Is it Japanese?
I know it's definitely
Japanese,
but I'm pretty sure it's like Chinese too. So
it's
wondering
possible.
If it's kind of...
With Chinese, the number 4 means death. It's very unlucky.
I was just trying to figure out how many total victims there were in the span of the movie and see if it was the number 4. And
oh, it's way more than 4.
Much more
than 4.
Way more than 4.
Because I was like, there was the two cabbies.
44. There's 44 victims.
Maybe women victims, because there's the fiance, the school bus girl,
but
the sister, and then the nurse.
But if you only count the ones that died, is it still more?
The ones that died.
Because it was like the wife,
girls that died,
guys in the cab, and the sister. Oh, well.
Three, didn't he kill that girlfriend of the psycho?
No.
Oh, I don't know. I don't think
cannibal?
So.
He just whacked her with a thing and then she died.
Oh.
I don't know if she's dead. She's just laying there.
She's playing dead. I don't know.
Unconfirmed. Well, this movie was filmed amazingly well. The cinematography was so beautiful.
Oh, yeah. The cab scene alone is some of the best cinematography you can think of. Like, they filmed it in two pieces. There's the external shots where they're filming the car, and then for the internal bits, they actually, like, cut off the top off of a cab and then, like, put up a plexiglass window and then spun the cab around with a stationary camera.
What?
While they were doing the stabbing and everything.
Awesome.
And they had 4 sets of costume for them, and they went through, I think it was like 6 takes for the entire thing or something like that.
Jesus.
So the final take, they had to go and like wash the clothes. So they were still kind of wet when they filmed it.
Oof. And it was really cold out, right? It looks like it anyway. I don't know if it actually was. Why did they spin the cab and not spin the camera?
Because they wanted that red shot.
I don't remember. Red shot?
Red shot.
From the Bruce Willis movie where he like spins in the car and like hops in when the car is spinning, just like all
maybe.
Cool. Like.
Because it was probably easier just to put them on just like a pedestal and then spin it rather than try to get the camera to move around.
Where Sorry, did you cultural where... touchstone red. Anyway, go ahead.
Wait, what?
I was saying like, you know, the cultural touchstone red.
Oh, the movie Red? Is that what you're talking about?
That's what Monica's talking about.
Yeah. The scene where Bruce Willis becomes God and controls a car. Like, you guys don't... Okay. That scene blew my mind. That movie was just kind of meh, but I watched that scene and I was like, what?
So this is a YouTube thing? Don't watch Red, just watch the car,
watch,
spinning
watch
car.
Red. It's fun. It's just...
I like...
Wait a minute. Brady, where did you hear about all of these details? Was this with the interview with the director?
Yes.
And is this, we'll put a, can we should put a link up on our YouTube?
I do.
Or,
I'll find it.
Okay, on our Facebook like, and stuff.
I found this through a link of a Google search, so I don't remember.
And this interview was conducted, it was in Korean?
No, it was an English interview. I don't remember. It may have been an American thing, but I think it was more of a website or a magazine.
Mm.
It wasn't. I don't think it was Fangoria, but it was something similar.
Has this director done an American film yet? I can't remember who has.
Yes, he did Last Stand with Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Mm-hmm.
Was that any good? Or
I heard it was decent. I have not seen it yet.
I think I put it on for background noise once, and I don't remember a damn thing about it.
It seems fun. It's just a big crescendo up until the end. It's the last stand. Clicky, clicky. any more moments of awesome or even nitpicks that we want to talk about before we do our final rating?
I think so.
We all good? Okay, Monica, did we change your mind at all?
I still really don't know where I stand. I'm somewhere between a 6 and a 7. Like,
think
I guess
about
I would
that
say
craft. Like it
I
is
would
such
say
a 7 film.
When it comes to recommending it to people. But for my own personal preferences, it's going to stay a 6.
So an 8.
I think it is a great film, and anybody who likes that kind of stuff, I'll be like, "Yeah, you should totally watch this. It was amazing." But I don't want to watch it again.
Hmm. Ready?
My initial rating was a 7, but I think after the conversations that we've had and the research that I did looking into the different cuts of the film, I think I do lean higher to an 8 at this point, just because they did put a lot of time and effort into it, and there was a lot of things that were taken out, but he still wanted to push for the film that he meant to make to begin with. So yeah, it's just kind of fun all around.
Fun?
Also, yeah, like...
You wouldn't really...
Remember, Brady has a warped sense of fun.
I know, but I just want to
get... It's not normal people fun, it's Brady.
I know. That's why I'm getting him to maybe rephrase that for the non-Brady people.
Brady.
People who aren't Brady.
Which are most.
They touch on a lot of interesting things, especially the ending, because my perspective, our hero, has a complete mental breakdown at the end. And, like, the weight of everything finally hits him and he just kind of goes hysterical. And I think from like just that perspective alone, they really pushed for a message that they really believed in. So even though they needed to edit the movie to be able to reach audiences, they still kept certain aspects. And I think that's like they did what they wanted to do. And when he was offered to be able to make the international cut and he extended it, to be able to push the ratings a little bit further, he finally got to get his more ideal film out. So,
but I know that last time Monica and I weren't sure, we weren't completely convinced that he was devastated at the end, or that he had. I mean, I agree that he has a breakdown, but I saw it partly as a release of emotion. Like, he had to go through all this just to be able to feel things about his wife, you know, being killed. Although at yeah. this point, it's the whole family by the end of the film. But it's a very ambiguous. I mean, it seems clear, but the more I think about it, the more ambiguous that ending becomes. I'm not sure what to make of the ending.
You can just watch the ending again. Like, to me, like, absolutely, he has a complete mental breakdown. And yes, it is partially because he had to turn everything off to do what he was doing.
Right.
But at the end, like, he starts laughing at first, and then yeah. he breaks into tears. And
so maybe it's the moment of realization that he realizes exactly right. what he's done.
Yeah,
right.
I think when I watched it, I felt like more like it was the first time he was actually able to grieve. But I can see where that's coming from right. too.
And
I don't know.
And I think that's where the title comes from. Is mm-hmm. it's pretty much the end when he realizes
he saw the devil in himself.
Right.
Yeah.
And
yeah, I can see that.
He also can't go back to being.
Yeah,
in the police because he can't stay in the police force right. because he had the former head of the police force killed because of his own negligence, right?
Basically.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Like, everything.
He can't return
is,
to his life at all.
Yeah, his life is completely changed now, and he cannot go back. Everything is destroyed.
The thing I love about the title is that the filmmaker never played with mirrors that I remember. He didn't do anything stupid and literal with mirrors that so many directors would have been tempted to do.
Yeah.
But anyway.
Like, look at yourself in the mirror.
Right, right. Because directors yeah. love to play with mirrors. But yeah. with that title, I'm glad he didn't do that.
Or in the movie Mirrors. Noel, did your number change at all?
No, because I still feel like craft-wise, it's at a very high level, without question. But I still feel like it still leaves me at arm's length, and I guess it's supposed to do that because there is that meta thing of baiting the audience of, like, don't you want to see vengeance, and then don't you, and then realizing that it's not working, and then don't you
I
want to see
you,
vengeance again?
I gave you all the things you wanted. Why don't
right,
you like it?
Exactly. Yeah. It keeps playing with you, but it starts to get repetitive, and I...
Are you not entertained?
Yeah.
Sorry.
What is that a reference to?
Gladiator.
Yeah. Oh, okay. See, all these films that I still need to see. I'm trying, you guys. I watched
Gladiator.
You're better than me, Noel.
I bit the bullet and watched Back to the Future last week just so
what?
I could. Boy, that was painful. Anyway,
did you watch all three?
Would have a heart attack.
Crystal's
husband would have a heart attack.
I know, but I have to get myself up to speed on all of these things that are at people's fingertips, like Gladiator. But anyway, I still want more from it. I still want, particularly looking at the other Korean films that have similarly brutal characters or brutal violence or relentlessness, there's so much more richness psychologically too. I think if we didn't have such a strong actor in the role of the serial killer, and I think we could have had a stronger actor in the role of our lead detective. I think he was very limited as an actor. And I think that a lot of the richness is just in the performance of the serial killer, you know, whereas some of the other films I've watched in this genre have it written in that there's richer characters. So I still don't know what is I know what's driving our main guy, but I still don't know what's driving the serial killer, and maybe that's not important, but I don't know. The film stops thematically, it stops at a certain point, you know what I mean? And it's repetitive, and it's supposed to be repetitive because you have to get tired of that cycle of vengeance and getting it and wanting to extend it. So I get the film. I don't think there's anything I'm not getting, but I still feel like there was more to mine. There's more there that I'm going to walk away from it remembering the sensation of watching it and not so much a level of complexity that I think it could have gone to, or that maybe, or some of the other films have gone to in terms of, particularly in terms of character. So
nothing can be good enough for you.
Well, what's your, I think you rated this one a lot higher than some of our other films.
Yeah, I know. I'm trying to get better about that. I mean,
it's your opinion. That's why it's interesting.
I know. I mean, this film, I know I'm not supposed to use decimals. It would be a 6.5 if I could do between 6 and 7, but Brady won't let me do that.
So that's
he slapped my hand about that the first episode I was on. So I want it to be a 7. It's so close, but there's also this thing about none of the women fighting back, which isn't true across the board with the Korean films I've seen. There's a lot tougher women in some of the other films that could have provided more, given the film more texture, or made it a little harder for Circular.
Cannibal's girlfriend fights back.
Whose does?
The cannibal's girlfriend.
Does she?
Yeah, she tries to fight the cop, and then gets punched in the face.
Oh, right. She fights our good guy. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well,
she barely does anything, though. And then she falls down, and her weird eyebrows are just... They're just weird.
So I want to give it a 7, but I want to give it a 6.5, but I'll keep it at a 6.
So it's an 8.
I mean, Brady, it is a great, it's a very powerful film, and it's a strong film, but yeah, it's never, nothing's ever good enough. You're basically right. I'm agreeing with you. No, yeah, some of the other ones I watched blew my mind and had all the things I wanted. So. Huh?
That I'm always right.
Well, that goes without saying. So.
Right.
Kinda.
All right. Well, I'm going to move mine up to a 7.
Yes. Now I really feel like a jerk.
After all the, I don't know, a lot of what Brady was saying from what he learned from the interview with the director kind of hit home. I thought that was interesting learning about the scene with the cab and the shots that were taken. Like, I already knew that it was at a whole nother level when it came to the cinematography, but I didn't know exactly what went into it. So that kind of helped me like, no, that's really cool. I'm going to bump it up. So... I think that was a big part of it. And then the fact that it wasn't just some simple, easy way to get my vengeance and get my rocks off. It was like, you have to question yourself and question why you're watching it every step of the way. Yeah. And I enjoyed that too. So despite the suffering of watching it, it was worth it. So a 7.
Good.
Awesome. Yes, I think I'm going to push mine up to an 8, Brady, because...
oh, come Brady on. It can't be the cutoff cab. If we knew about how all movies were made, we would marvel at the...
Except for Michael Bay movies.
Except for what?
Michael Bay movies, sorry.
Yeah.
Other than The Rock, but we'll discuss.
We got to talk about that later. Michael Bay, a whole episode. Okay.
Or not.
I love Min Sik Choi, old boy. He Odaisu. He's just a wonderful actor. I think he's the Korean Harvey Keitel, or Harvey Keitel is the American.
He's the better one than Harvey.
The script to the director to say we should do this movie.
Oh, is that how? Is that what happened?
Mm-hmm.
That's cool.
Wait a minute. So the script wasn't written by the director?
No.
Oh, okay. That's interesting. Oh, all right. I think he's much better than Harvey. I think he has a wider range than Harvey Keitel is, but I hear what you're saying. There is this, there is the same gene pool.
I love him, and I've seen him in multiple other roles. And yeah. You are correct, Nolan, that he's very sympathetic in some roles. And his range is so crazy. Like, I'm so scared of him, and also I love him so much, yeah. And
it's funny, like, I have seen him in a lot of roles too, but he is always Odaisu to me, always.
Odaisu is the character from Old Boy.
And that is the most powerful thing I saw him in.
Yeah, he gets to play his full range in Old Boy. He gets to do the full, but he's a theater actor in Korea, and I would love to see him in I'm sure he's he would be an amazing King Lear. I mean, I'm sure he's done all the great roles because most of his career has been on stage there. So anyway,
he's incredible. He did this early movie with
maybe he's not old enough for
Park Chan Wook, and it was called Shiri, and it stars that lady from Lost, and it's a super early cop drama. It's great, and I think
Shiri.
I think he's also in Joint Security Area. Which is an amazing movie. Wait, I'll say that for recommendations. Anyway, he's great. This movie is just, you know, it has it all. I'm such a huge fan of South Korean cinema in general. You know, they're just unlike anybody else when it comes to this kind of craft. Crafting a thriller, and especially a thriller that's focused more towards like horror aspects. And also the fact that this me as a fan of revenge movies, that this takes it to a place that's uncomfortable for me, which is much like, and no spoilers, don't worry, Game of Thrones does this too, where you hate and want revenge on this character, and you want this character to get what's coming to them, and then when that happens, you're not happy about it because
no, not at all.
They don't do it right. You're like, yeah. Oh no, this is the real
world.
It
was the moment I'd been waiting for the whole show, and then when it happened, I was like, I don't feel right about this.
What do you feel like
about the same thing, Mons?
Yeah.
Do you feel like the character didn't do it right, or that?
No, it's amazing. It's no, amazing.
Are we talking really about the cake? Are we talking about that moment?
No, I'm not talking about
Joffrey
specifics right now.
Oh, okay.
But a lot of characters, you hate them, and you want this, you want bad things to happen to them, and when the show actually does that for you, when the story, the writing is so good that when the story does that for you, it just, you know, it takes your breath away because you're like, okay, well, you gave me what I wanted, but it's completely not what I thought it was going to be, and I feel mean-spirited for thinking about doing this to this person.
So you think that you think Game of Thrones is doing a similar thing that this movie's doing, of showing you how revenge doesn't work?
George R. R. Martin is, like, notorious about... Well, I mean, everybody knows him for the guy who kills everybody, but the thing is he kills everybody in the most unusual and more realistic ways. They're not satisfying as they should be, but it's more like, yeah, that happened in real life. Okay.
So it doesn't tie up into a neat bow that these deaths don't resolve anything or solve anything?
I'm still waiting for somebody just to die of gangrene in the show. Like, that's just the way he
I
goes.
Haven't showered in months.
Like tetanus.
Yeah, like tetanus or something. Like, I'm waiting for that because that's... And it's going to be the biggest, most epic warrior, and they're going to die from tetanus.
You have died of dysentery.
Yeah, exactly. That's going to be him because it's like, I don't know, he takes the glory out of some deaths. Mm. And it's more realistic then because death and vengeance isn't always beautiful and...
Right.
Savory, I guess would be the word. Yeah.
Go ahead. No, it's going to be a complete derail. So.
Oh, I was going to say Kenda, the woman that's actually read the books. I've just seen the show.
Is she right? Does somebody die of gangrene? Or tetanus?
At this point, the books and the TV show.
Oh, I've completely,
They've caught up, and now they're going to be two separate stories completely. So don't worry.
So the whole, everybody's going to go ape poopy about it.
Ape poopy.
Which is better, the show or the new books?
We should make you a shirt that says ape poopy.
Well, I'm trying to protect Monica's family.
Okay.
From thy
DOT
foul.
I still
wanted somebody to explain to me, I mean, not you guys, but I want to get a better sense of why Korea right now is, or in the last, I don't know, 5, 6, 7 years, are just obsessed with the revenge thing. Because it's just like every one of these movies.
Because it's fun.
No, there's something's going on. This explosion
kind
of a certain...
I had a theory when you were talking about it the first time, and I was thinking about Crystal. Crystal is the most reserved person I know. Like, she is the calmest person. Anytime, I've lived with her for several years, and anytime there'd be a fight in the house, she was always the one that was like, okay, you guys... Just take a step back, calm down. Just calm down, you guys. Like, but her
but I
favorite
think the films, more horrible thoughts.
Yeah, because she's so refrained from any sort of even like. Sorry, I just read a book about Scientology. Any level of your voice tone, like she keeps hers all. Whenever, like, the more stressful the situation gets, the more like monotone her tone gets because she stays calm. But because of that, vengeance movies are her favorite, and the ones where people just like rip people's heads off are her favorite because it's almost an outlet.
It's cathartic.
For that vengeance. Some people just kill Laura Croft a million times. She watches
crazy.
I Saw the Devil.
Yeah. No, I think that there's got to be something in there, you know, and also, but there has to, but I still think it's somehow related to the fact that the people who were the military dictatorship are still alive. And when you've got the sort of enemies or the people who oppressed you are now your neighbors and you're all happy under a democracy. I mean, this has happened in other cultures as well. I feel like that has to have something to do with it, but again, mm-hmm. I'm speculating.
That is a very popular theory, for the record. Like, you're not the only one. That is pretty big.
So Brady just wants to let me know that I'm not as smart as I think I am. No. Actually, you did the opposite. You confirmed for me that I'm not completely off base. Yeah.
Right.
Yes.
You are as smart as you think you are. So, you know, take the compliment.
I will.
So going back to what Crystal was saying about, you know, how you want something from the director or from a writer, especially when it comes to revenge, and then they give it to you and it's totally not what you wanted or what you expected. Like, that totally made me think of every movie I've ever seen, like, a depiction of the devil in. When people are making deals with the devil, it's always like they expect something out of the bargain, and then it always comes back and bites them in the booty, and it's terrible. I feel like that totally plays into the title of it too, but I don't know if that's
Saw the devil.
That's how the devil is depicted, though, in Korean culture, so I don't know if that's a fair, like, relation to make, but that's what I thought of. I was like,
It's a really, really cool observation, actually.
Interesting, yeah.
I
mean, cinema, it could be a wider comment on cinema, too. That
could be.
You're going to the cinema to see the devil, you know, you're going to see the most extreme, the most evil. It's the only place you can go to see that. Well,
yeah.
One of the
places. I watch the movies I watch.
recommendations. Monica?
So I went for a vengeance theme in my recommendations, just movies about vengeance that I do enjoy. We mentioned in the 31 Days of Horror, one of them, Hard Candy. I adore that movie. It's one of the early Ellen Page films, and it's about a girl who, just watch it. Watch it. It's awesome. The other one would be Lady Vengeance. We brought that one up before. That's seriously one of my, like, top.
Brady's keeping a tally.
Yes.
I love it.
And the last one is John Wick. I love that movie, too. It's almost got this same feel where it's just, like, the main character is very, like, deadpan the whole film, and you only see, like, two outbreaks of emotion from him. But, I don't know. I
love Keanu. Who plays John Wick?
Keanu Reeves. Yeah.
Oh, Monica, I was just thinking about John Wick, too, because imagine that this has a society of serial killers who are best friends, and that's a society of assassins.
Yeah.
Anyway, I love
these two, like, the two main characters are actually, like, best friends.
So you guys would recommend John Wick?
Yes.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
I love John Wick.
I mean, is he watchable? He's
perfect for the role.
Perfect for the role.
Keanu Reeves nails the roles where he's either got to be deadpan or he's got to be the character that you can relate to. Like The Matrix. The reason why The Matrix was so successful is not because he was a great actor, but because you could put yourself in his shoes. He is a great actor for that kind of role where the director is trying to get you to project yourself as the main character.
Oh, that's interesting.
Because that's what they were saying about The Matrix, too. They originally wanted to cast Will Smith, but Will Smith has way too much character, way too much personality, and people that watch Will Smith movies, while they enjoy them,
they don't see themselves.
They can't see themselves in that role. So Keanu Reeves is the perfect actor for that type of role.
Like a vessel that people
Exactly. He's like a blank slate almost.
Yeah, interesting.
And so when he does other movies where he's not like that, sometimes it's okay. I still love Bill and Ted. I will always love Bill and Ted.
Well, everybody says that's his best performance by far.
Yeah, the one time.
That's not his best performance, but it's his most animated.
Yeah, it's his most animated performance. But in John Wick, he is a deadpan, and
it's a revenge story?
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
Very much so.
Okay, that's
good.
You would think it would be
about, like, a lover, but no, it's pretty interesting what it's about. The revenge.
It's so fantastic how, and especially a film fan, when you watch it, it's much like the latest Mad Max in that all the visual shorthand is there. There's no questions. Everything on screen, you're like, yep, got it.
And there's a lot of scenes too, like Old Boy, where it's like one shot. These fight scenes are one shot, and there's
It comes to all the gunplay, like, they are very good about. He only has a certain number of bullets in his gun, and he has to reload.
Yeah, John Wick's definitely a good movie.
I think I counted maybe two times where he fired one extra bullet.
So you're saying it's super detailed and it sticks to...
It's pretty fantastic.
It was directed by the stuntman.
It's so popular and people loved it so much that literally the game Payday made John Wick a character you can play in that game to do heists and bank robberies.
I did not know that. That's amazing.
Yeah.
sequel coming soon in production.
You'll see where he's John Wick and he is always John Wick.
Anyway.
Okay, so...
Brady!
So I'm going to jump on the Keanu Reeves train here.
Oh, no.
And first off, Keanu Reeves.
The Watcher. Just.
I was just thinking about that one.
Wait a minute. What does this have to do with Ice on the Devil?
If you'd give me a second.
Oh, okay. Sorry. Sorry. Your hat is making you look thuggish now.
Is that better?
Yes. No, it makes. It fit with your demeanor. It was working there.
Right. So, The Watcher. The Watcher is very interesting because it follows the story of a cop. My hair is going to be crazy for the rest of this. who is being contacted by a serial killer.
Oh, okay.
The cop was trying to put the serial killer away, and now the serial killer is very much toying with him.
Mm. Stalking.
And it's... fantastic. It is probably my favorite Keanu Reeves film ever made. 100%. Amazing.
It was the first time he tried to do the darker role.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, he plays the serial killer?
Yes.
Oh.
He's the bad guy, and it's so good.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So good.
He's interesting. The bad guy in The Gift.
Yeah, but The Gift came after The Watcher.
The Gift?
I don't remember.
Isn't that... That's not the recent thing with...
That's a Sam Raimi movie with Kate Blanchett.
Oh, right. Okay.
Right.
Monica, you double-check me.
And if you want to watch something that's fairly entertaining and not really revenge-y, sort of.
They came out the same year.
Man of Tai Chi.
Sorry,
Man of Tai Chi?
Is it?
Oh, I like that movie. That was
when he directed, right?
It's Keanu Reeves directed.
It's got the guy...
So there are a lot of Keanu Reeves connections. Interesting.
Right.
And who's the guy in the Man of Tai Chi other than...
I can't remember off the top of my head, but I watched it because Keanu Reeves directed it, and it's very much... it's about this guy who's like trying to make money to save the temple where he learned Tai Chi, and he starts going more violent. Like, he gets... brought into an underground fighting tournament thing, so there is kind of a moral dilemma that's very much, it's kind of similar to the whole I Saw the Devil moral situation, but not completely. Like, he doesn't quite lose his mind, but he starts going down the path that he's not the good guy at this point. He needs to do the right thing, and
the Man of Tai Chi, I tried looking it up, but then I remembered the main actor in that movie was actually Keanu Reeves' stunt double in The Matrix.
Right.
The guy who did all stunts, and they became best friends, and then they've just kind of worked together.
Right.
Like,
right.
He's always given him advice and training and stuff like that. They've, and then they did that movie. That movie's good. Yeah, that's a good
recommendation. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah.
So, not horror by any means, but still, I think
it's still going down the dark path.
Right.
Yeah, I guess it's making me realize that compared to Eyes of the Devil, American revenge films are so watered down. I mean, it just doesn't even compare. It's like a different... Mm-hmm. I guess you can't really go any further than I Saw the Devil in terms of a revenge film. I don't know. Or Old Boy or any of these Korean... They're taking revenge films as far as
they can. Look how watered down we got with the Old Boy remake.
Oh, I never saw the remake.
It's horrible.
Yeah, I've heard it's
a completely... It's a mediocre film... as an unnecessary remake of a fantastic movie.
Like this upcoming Martyrs remake, I'm sure, is going to be.
Oh, I've heard terrible things.
Yeah, it's gotten bad reviews.
I don't know if I can make myself watch it, even though I kind of want to compare. I'm a little bit... Anyway.
It's not.
Yeah. No.
Well, that's kind of a revenge movie, the first half. Anyway.
The first half,
Yeah.
No, what are you doing?
So I have to recommend some of the other Korean extreme thriller police films. I love Memories of Murder, which is about a serial killer, although the gore, it's far more focused on again, incompetent cops, which is a common theme, or at least old school incompetent cops out in the in this small village where the killings are taking place, and then you've seen this story before, but a young guy comes from, Seoul, and is
Let me
supposed to
think of that.
help them out and show these country bumpkins how we're going to catch this. And of course, nothing goes as planned. And that's by Bong Joon-ho, who directed The Host, which is wonderful. And he also directed, what else did he direct that I saw? Help me out, Crystal. What else did
Mother.
he? Mother. Oh my God. Yeah, Mother
I
was.
love Mother.
Wow, Mother's a kick. Mother's a tough film, but it's so complicated. But I love Bong Joon-ho. Those three films are all really good. But as far as thrillers go, Memories of Murder, I don't even know what to call Mother. Incest comes up a lot in these films too, and it's hinted at in Mother. Well, it's at the edge of Mother. I mean, they sleep in the same bed, so it's a little creepy. And Bong Joon-ho, there's a character in Mother and a character in Memories of Murder of a mentally challenged character. So he's interested in that too, and sort of putting that personality in the middle of all this other stuff that's going on.
Both of those are in Park Chan-wook movies too.
Oh, really?
Incest and mentally challenged people.
Yeah.
Which one is Park Chan-wook? That's Old
He's
Boy.
the old boy,
The
Mr.
Vengeance
Vengeance.
trilogy.
Who was the mentally challenged character in Old Boy? I can't remember.
It's in Mr. Vengeance.
Oh,
Yeah,
okay.
Mr. Vengeance is the.
Certainly we know where the incest goes. I would also recommend Chaser was a lot of fun, more of a comedic take on this. And then I also Yellow, yeah, I can't really recommend Yellow Sea, because that some of the Korean thrillers have, like, where the cop is young and dashing, and it goes into Bond territory. So I think avoid those, because those are really silly. And Korean directors are not above having little girls. That's a big thing, of like the little kid comes into the picture, and the bad or the unfeeling male has to, bend and melt to. So they will go for the sentimentality occasionally, which always baffles me, because it's such a great remove from the intensity of the violence and the visceral. But the little girl thing happens in The Host, and it happens in Chaser, and it happens in some of the others I watched. I would just say, shoot, I can't think of other names, but
Just watch all of the movies.
well, I was just going to say that it's a fascinating genre, and each of the films that I've watched, I have certainly far from watched them all, but they're still churning them out. Every year, there's more. So it's not like this genre is ending anytime soon, or it's not over. So it's something to engage yourself with. I don't know. South Korean thriller, crime, what would you call it,
Yeah,
Crystal?
I'm all
Yeah.
for it.
Yeah.
South Korean thrillers, extreme thrillers.
I just hope that more women start coming into the stories. I hope that more women are
Watch
involved.
Lady Vengeance.
Yeah, sure. And Mother. Watch Mother
Yes.
just for that we have a lead. What was the last time you saw a crime thriller that were I don't know, 68-year-old woman is the lead character? So watch Mother just for that.
Hans, please watch Mother. You
Those all
especially.
just sold me.
It'll blo but I
Sold it.
mean, it'll blow your mind. It's this talk about not being able to predict where a film's going.
And
Whew.
now I've got Danzig stuck in my head again. Oh, is that
That's
the song, the Mother
not a bad
song?
way to go.
Yeah.
Kenda, what are your recommendations?
So I'm gonna recommend the same film last time we talked, because I don't have any experience with any Korean movies yet, other
You have
than this
one.
one. So just one so far. So I'm just gonna go with the foreign movie genre and go with The Abandoned, made in
Yeah.
2006.
Oh, that was really
That was
good.
so
Yeah.
good.
What country does that come from, though?
It's like Russia or
Yeah,
something.
it's
Well, it's set in
Russian.
Yeah.
Russia, but
And a
is it a
punk.
Russian-made film?
I think so.
I think I
They
remember
speak
it
Russian.
being in Russian. Yeah.
Yeah, the majority of it's all in subtitles, and there's time loops, and it's
Yeah.
really cool and really weird and different. So I enjoyed it.
That movie is pretty fantastic.
Yeah. It's been a while since I've seen it. I'll have to watch it again.
Yeah, me too. I was just thinking about that.
So there is an American remake now, or one has
No,
been
it is not a
made?
remake. It is
It's
a
just the
completely
same
different.
title? Okay.
Yes.
All right.
Yeah. So 2006 one. That's
Yeah.
the one we're talking about.
Okay.
Yeah.
I just don't see how Americans can do the can do any more of these Korean dramas. I mean, it's obvious that they can't. It's just not possible. I mean, it wouldn't be the MPAA wouldn't it would go out as an X. It would be impossible, right?
Yeah, they'd have to really, really take it down a notch.
Yeah, I mean, we've got there are a few movies where they kind of push the boundaries, but I don't think we have one movie that pushes all of the boundaries at the same time.
There's
And it still
television
has a
now.
super wide release.
Right.
Yeah, you can
But
only do it on television.
with
You
the
remember
fact
when
that we're getting a
that on
lot
like
of
HBO?
you could do something as sorry, Brady. Brady's getting cut off again. Go ahead.
Brady, tell us.
We're getting a lot of like TV, not really TV, but like episodic sort of things and movies made for Netflix and Sony and well, because Sony's got powers, which I think I talked about one point in time, for their streaming stuff, and it's Sony's series, and they pushed a lot of boundaries with that. Like it is kind of gory all around, and it's basically a TV series.
Powers is the superhero
Yes,
series
the
that you say
superhero
is,
cop drama that I
yeah.
fell in love with. We've got Jessica Jones and Daredevil. Like those movies or those TV series are getting, they're starting to push boundaries too. So if we
Orange is the
start,
New Black pushes lots of
right,
boundaries.
absolutely. So there's a possibility that we start might start getting movies pushing boundaries too, but made specifically for Netflix and such.
That,
So.
yeah, that is an interesting concept because our, in general, the reason why it didn't happen before is because there were regulations for
Right.
cinema and television networks had their own regulations, but on something like Netflix or
Exactly.
As
Amazon
soon as it's
Prime,
private in this
they run
country,
their
you do
own
whatever you want.
show.
Right. We're not going to get a blockbuster, but it's going to be available for a huge area. Like we
But
just
some
put
of
it
those
on.
shows are just as big as the everything
Yeah.
else
Oh,
coming out.
absolutely. So, I mean, Netflix could make a movie that is pushing a lot of boundaries, and it could be a high rated R, and basically, it doesn't have to worry about being like a blockbuster. I mean, they could charge an extra like $2 and probably make the same amount of money as to be able to make it a decent
Yeah.
profit.
I mean, these Korean films look very expensive, are they? Or are they just cleverly
They're
made to look expensive?
I think they're pretty expensive because if you compare it to like the most ambitious Japanese filmmakers, they don't even come close.
Right.
Like,
I think it's a little bit of both. Like they are doing a lot of
do they
camera
have
work.
one of those tax breaks if they film in Korea? They get, I know certain countries do
I
that.
don't know, but I know that they are they're pushing very they're doing a lot of camera work, very a lot of more practical effects all around. And I think
And that's more
that is
expensive, right?
at this point in time is a lot less expensive than doing the special effects and doing all the shiny stuff, the technical.
Wait.
No,
I thought the
it's
practical's been more expensive than the digital.
if you make practical look good, it's more expensive. It depends on what you're doing.
Right.
In Korean cinema, it seems like just the filmmaking aspect itself, filming it, getting the sets, making it look as gorgeous as it does, the cinematography. That is where all the money is going. It's all on
Right.
screen.
Yeah. And also, so many of these films are set in like real places. They're on the street in Korea and in the Yellow Sea, partly in China, or at least it looks like China, or it's supposed to be China. But I it's wonderful to see, real places and not and that's probably more expensive, I would think. Or those streets look so narrow and it's such a crowded place, it looks like it can't be easy.
Yeah, the only
Well,
thing I can think of is that permits are easier to get, and
likely.
they support the arts a bit more, which I think maybe Japan doesn't do it as much. And maybe that's why the films seem a
Maybe.
bit more restricted. Sorry, Brie, did you have another tidbit you want to mention before
I was going to
I
say, like,
explode
comparing
with
it
recommendations?
to compare it to like American films in general, we've got such a large country that
Yeah,
it's
and sheer
there
size
are
of
a lot of
audience,
things
yeah.
to go, a lot of hoops to jump through to be able to do some of these, like, locations.
Yeah.
Whereas
each state has its own rules too.
Right. Whereas in Korea, I mean, you can basically drive across the country in the time that it takes to for us to drive through a couple states, you know. So it's easier to transport around.
Mm.
But in terms of comparing it to Japan, I think Japan's money is just going other directions. Like I linked you the video Dorian Gray's Obscure, and there's a lot of effects in that music video, and it tends at the time, like a couple of my friends were joking about how there's a higher budget for that music video than some of the horror films that were coming out.
Now, were they saying it looked like it, or actually that was the case?
It's not completely the case, but we were just saying it looked like it. It's still a lot of money went into this music video, so I just think that Japan's money is going just different directions.
It was hard to imagine looking at all the credits and all the lists, the long list of producers for a particular I Saw the Devil. It's just hard to imagine this director tromping this script around and people saying, oh, here's a check for, you know, it's just like that. I don't think that would certainly never happen in this country. Right. The materials just too strong.
Maybe there were so many producers just because he needed that many people.
Sure.
To get it could have been who was attached to the film too. I mean, we had Odaisu and
he's a big star. Yeah.
Yeah.
And Storm Shadow.
Yeah. I mean, it had a pretty amazing, like for them, like their all-star cast director.
Yeah.
And, they're just these guys are getting together. Take all my money.
Right.
Please,
the cast of this film is tremendous.
I still think Storm Shadow could be better.
No, he's fantastic.
Horror hottie of the month.
Anyway, we're pretty.
Oh, right.
Pretty big
tangent. Whoa. I got recommendations.
Crystal's got to do her recommendations.
Oh, sorry.
Sorry, time to go. Bye, Crystal.
Bye. All right, so. I mentioned before that Odaisu was in Joint Security Area. I'm a complete liar. It's not him. It's actually Storm Shadow, and the other guy.
So
the guy that did
can
the
we just stuff? To viewers? Can we
Kang
just say?
Kang Ho Song.
Sorry.
Kang Ho Song from The Host and Snowpiercer. They're both in it. Anyway, I'm just correcting that. That movie's cool if you want to check out. My recommendations, I have two of them. One is Stoker, which is Park Chan-wook's American debut. It stars Nicole Kidman and Mia Wasikowska and Matthew Good. And it is such a weird little movie about a coming-of-age story for a young woman. And it's just done in the most sordid, strange way. Nicole Kidman just flits around the house like a Tennessee Williams character. And I adore it. And I've never been so uncomfortable in a theater with other people watching a movie.
Interesting.
So it's really intimate and in the weirdest way possible. And I would highly recommend that. My second recommendation would be The World of Kanako. It's finally getting a theatrical release in America this year, a wider theatrical release. So check it out. It's
Kanako.
Yes, it's by the director of Kamikaze Girls. And it's probably the movie that jarred me. Like, I hadn't been jarred as very much lately in the theater since I Saw the Devil. This one jarred me again, and it is the most intense series of events that you can imagine. It's about this kind of deadbeat detective dad who gets called back home to find out where his daughter is because his mom called and said, oh, your daughter's missing. You have to find out where she is. And it's kind of like a Twin Peaks-esque Laura Palmer situation where you're like finding out how sordid and strange this girl's life was. And your hero is a horrible person. And
her father.
Yeah, the father is a horrible person. It's such a crazy movie, and I've never felt like I've been shook by the shoulders for like 2 hours like this movie. Definitely check it out. The soundtrack's insane, and it has this great juxtaposition with and unlike the other Japanese movies I've been mentioning, this one has pretty high budget. There's a juxtaposition in how bubbly and cartoony the musical cues and character choices there are versus how dark and horrifying everything that's going on is. And I would definitely check it out if you're in for more more punishment. If you like I Saw the Devil, definitely check out The World of Kanako.
Hmm. Kanako is the daughter's name?
Yeah. It's great. Brady.
What?
Who is your horror hottie of the month?
Storm Shadow, I already said that.
So can we get his actual name, please? So probably. That people have some idea what Storm the hell Shadow? We're talking about. His name is Byung-hun Lee.
Yes, that.
And he is, like, stunning. I mean, he's unearthly beauty.
Yes, very, very pretty.
1970. He was born in 1970. He's only 2 years younger than me. So he can't look. How is he this? That's not possible.
Asian empire.
Asian powers.
Basically Asian.
He looks.
Asian powers activate.
Oh my god.
However you activate Asian powers.
He was also in Terminator Genesis as the T-1000 in that, which I thought was a fantastic choice. So, yeah.
He was in The Good, the Bad, and the Weird, which is the previous film by the guy who directed I Saw the Devil. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, he was because, in Three Extremes.
Or it was... Yeah, so
he's in JSA. Made... He is in JSA. Mm-hmm. Oh, that was what you said.
Yeah, I was correcting. It wasn't...
Right. And then he's in a Magnificent Seven. I guess it's a remake. And I wonder who's directing that.
Right, I had brought that up last time.
He's actually in Red, or Red 2.
He's actually in quite a few American things that I mean people just haven't really noticed. So I don't know. He's fantastic. That's why I said he's wonderful in this movie because we've seen him act different ways, and he does a very good like just emotionless person. Still. So I think he was cast perfectly in I Saw the Devil. Personally.
So when are these actors going to be doing American films? That's the thing. It's like, it seems like
I mean,
they're...
he has been, like I said, he's in Terminator Genesis. He's in,
that's
G.I. Joe.
He's in more American films than Oldboy is.
Yeah. Min-Sik Choi is, I don't think he's in hardly any American films, but I guess there's always that language barrier. That's yes. Not easy, you know?
Mm-hmm. I mean, all around it is. I mean, there's a few Japanese directors that have tried to come and do some English sort of films. Like, if you've ever seen Sukiyaki Western Django.
Sukiyaki Western Django?
Who's in that.
That's the title?
What's his name? What's his name? Miike or whatever.
Takashi Miike?
Takashi Miike.
Yes, that one. he's done a lot of, I guess.
Yeah, but he makes seven films
Japanese
a year.
Films,
so
that's true.
Ichi the Killer and such, and he decided to do an all English, and it's the entire cast other than Quentin Tarantino is Japanese. And
the main guy in Sukiyaki Western Django is.
Is that Django D J N G O like yes. Django Unchained?
Is one of the guys from Battle Royale.
Mm-hmm.
The crazy kid with the hair that gets his eyes burned. Yeah.
But honestly, I was thinking that I was watching J-Horror and I was even thinking about, you know, the only Miike film he's supposed to be so violent out there. And the only one I've seen is Audition and everybody goes ape poopy for that. It's like, that is nothing compared to what these Korean films are doing. That is
it's
so nothing.
Even though
it's
really
stuff.
Good. I think with Audition, it's a because your expectations aren't
right. It's intense.
It starts out like a love story.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I don't know.
Where you audition for your wife.
The violence in the Japanese films doesn't even come close to what's in these Korean films.
It's a different aspect of the violence, I think. I don't know. Watch Ichi the Killer.
But I know that some of Miike's stuff is really out there, so it's not like I'm an expert. I know that he can get pretty extreme.
Yeah, he works with some strange concepts. But yeah, so things.
Yes, Brady, tell us about our email.
Right. Got an email address, tellusyourfears@gmail.com. You can send your hate mail, requests, conversations, tips, suggestions.
Subjections.
Whatever.
Objections and
right.
Suggestions. Just
your send e-bites.
To your suggestions.
Yeah, everything that if you want to tell us anything rather than just going to the one of us that has directed you to our show, just email tellusyourfears @gmail.com, and then that way we'll all be able to do whatever with the information, so we don't have to basically, yeah, whatever.
Yes,
definitely.
Or you can send us pictures of cats. That works too.
I guess if you want.
Do that, and we'll forward straight to Kenda's inbox. So yes, please subscribe to us on Stitcher under What Doesn't Kill Us, and on our YouTube channel under the Fight or Flight Network.
Like, comment, subscribe, rate, all of that stuff. It does help us in what we do.
Please do. Our next movie that we're going to discuss is one that is near and dear to my heart as an extreme horror fan. Sorry to do this to you guys again, but we're going to make it. We're going to see Martyrs finally and discuss it. So I'm very excited for this.
It is my first time for that too. So I haven't watched it yet because
Ken just too.
So,
yeah.
I've seen it twice, and I thought that was going to be, like, all I ever saw it.
You don't need Sorry, to watch You probably don't need to watch it again to talk
no,
about it.
No, I do.
It.
It's been a really long time.
I'm going
to
watch it three times just for you, Monica.
Okay. What other horror movie podcast has the guts to do I Saw the Devil and then their next episode
right after
Martyrs? So
we Who should... was it? Somebody... The reason why you and I watched it, Crystal, was somebody... Some director said it was, like, the worst, like... the hardest film to watch they'd ever seen. And that's the reason.
I can't remember either.
Like, the reason why we watched it is we used to... What is that? What's that website we used to go to?
Bloody Disgusting.
Bloody Disgusting. Mm. Yeah, they do articles.
I still go.
I do occasionally. I think, actually, I only go to the links you send me. But we used to go to that regularly, and then they had this one big write-up about Martyrs, and it was, like, from a director that we both liked, said it was, like, the hardest film... he's ever watched. Like, it was the hardest one to watch.
So
we're just like,
well,
I'm gonna get this.
So that's...
I wouldn't. I'm glad I didn't see it in the theater where you can't stop
God,
and it's
no.
that big. I mean, that's a film
I
probably
would
wouldn't...
have thrown up in the theater.
Yeah,
you guys.
I don't know if you would have back then.
What?
No, back then I might not have. But now, yeah.
No, we would have just been like,
I'm such a softer person now.
Don't you remember the days when we were hardened? Hardened, militant, evil women. Well, I guess that...
That'll wrap it up.
That wraps it up. Thank you guys for joining us. And look forward to next episode. It might be one of our what we've been watchings, but please definitely stay tuned for our next film review, Martyrs. All right, bye, everyone.
Good night,
bye.
Thanks.
Good night.
Okay, bye.